Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Neil Haley Show. Really excited. You can go to my website, TotalTutor.net, for more information. Twitter, Total Tutor. Neil S. Haley, Facebook, LinkedIn, Neil Haley, Instagram, Total Tutor, Pinterest, Neil Haley, and Google Plus. TV and radio days are so much fun because you could see me. But we have some really interesting guests today, definitely in the portion of Author's Corner if you watch the entire, listen to the entire network and watch it. And it's all about the Miami Book Fair series. You can go to miamibookfair.com to check out more information. It's November 16th, the 23rd. Fantastic. A place that it's all about books, great authors, the fans, everybody. And this is part of the Miami Book Fair series. So I'm so excited to welcome the program author David Altshuler. He's author of Raising Healthy Kids in an Unhealthy Environment. David, thanks for calling. How are you?
Never better, Neil. Thank you for having me on.
Oh, I'm glad to have you on the program. And how excited are you about going to the Miami Book Fair?
Mitch Kaplan has often been referred to as a saint. He is the nicest man in Miami. I have had the honor and pleasure of knowing him for half a century. We've been friends our entire lives. He's my neighbor. Our kids carpool together. And if there's anyone in this community who does more for us, I can't imagine who it might be. I am thrilled to be part of his Miami Book Fair this year.
Oh, I mean, always he does such a fantastic job, and the authors are so fantastic. And David, I learned so much, but this definitely connects to my education background. But I want to learn more about you for this first segment. Specifically enough, tell us your background and specifically how you got involved, especially with children.
I was teaching a kid for whom mathematics did not come easy.
Okay.
The more impassioned I became about sharing my love of the quadratic formula, the less connected he became to the lesson. I pride myself as a craftsman. If you can't factor trinomials, we'll multiply binomials, we'll look at monomials, we'll learn our multiplication right. tables. And I was leaping around the room, Neil. And finally, this kid, as his frustration grew and my inability to connect became more apparent, stood up, looked me in the eye, and told me that I was and part of the anatomy that is not pronounceable on the radio. I called his mom and said, we can't work together. And then it occurred to me, no is the beginning of a consultation, not the end of one.
Yes, definitely.
I wanted to stop teaching math. I wanted to start teaching children. And
wow.
That's when I became a consultant.
So that's interesting. Was that in the classroom setting when you were working with kids with math as a math teacher?
I was a math teacher. This happened to be when I ran a tutoring and test preparation shop for about 20 years. This was a one-on-one session.
Okay.
But I'll never forget that kid and the disservice that all of us as educators did to him, not finding who he was, not aligning with him,
right.
not being attuned to him, teaching him that which was important to us rather than that which would be helpful to him.
And that's very interesting. When I tutor kids, David, I always look at specifically the whole person, not just, well, we're teaching them math or we're teaching them reading, because if you don't make that connection, so I see what you saw, you can help more and more people being a consultant. That's what you pretty much, the light bulb came on, right, David?
I'm glad we're on the same team. It sounds like you got that memo earlier in your career than I did. But you and I are on the same side of a big divide, and I'm glad we're together.
Well, exactly, because every individual student, David, it's not a one-size-fits-all education system. Every child is different. They learn
well
differently,
said.
All that.
Well said.
Absolutely. Okay, so you went from having this tutoring and consulting business to going straight to a consulting. Did you go right into the classroom and consult with teachers? What did you do after that?
I said, I want to help every child who comes
okay.
to me. And I want to be able to put them in rehab if they need it, or to get them help for their addictions to screens. The first time I heard a child say, if you take away my device, I'll kill myself, was about 10 years ago. Heard it from 16-year-olds. Now I hear it from 11-year-olds. If children have learning differences, if children are self-harming, whatever they need, if it's a top college, that's fine. But I want to help the children take the next step. And I want to help the families come to understand that not everyone fits the Dartmouth or die paradigm, and that indeed there's a right college and there's a right placement for every child.
I see. So basically, in a lot of ways, you're consulting with the parents and the child, and that's your ultimate goal, and looking at the whole self of that child, seeing that, you know, if it's a teenager and they're having drug issues, that's where you're going to be your focus, getting them in therapy, getting them extra help. But if it's something, you know, getting them into the right college, then you're focusing on study skills. So you do the whole gamut of things, it sounds like.
Exactly right.
All right. So looking at your background, again, your education before that, I'm going to kind of step back before we get into the book in the second segment. Now, David, when you were in college and stuff, what were you studying?
You are gracious to ask, my friend. I was studying how to move from being an adolescent myself to an adult, but my double major is in English literature and in mathematics from the University of Wisconsin. And then at the University of Miami in graduate school, I got a master's degree in developmental psychology thanks to the help and graciousness of some wonderful mentors and brilliant teachers. And I try to honor their legacy by helping kids find the right place.
Oh, okay, okay. So from then on, you went, David, into specifically the working with kids and consulting education-wise, but it was only on the education front, not all the other areas, right?
And then a couple of centuries ago, I connected with my wonderful professional organization. I hope you'll allow me to give a shout-out to the Independent Educational Consultants Association, with whom I have toured hundreds of facilities, colleges, boarding schools, therapeutic boarding schools, residential treatment centers, so that I now feel comfortable and competent to guide families in the right direction. I was on a bus in Massachusetts last week visiting boarding schools, in Utah 3 weeks ago looking at residential treatment facilities. I'm going to Central Florida on Monday to see more colleges and facilities. It's a great group, and the information and the love on those buses as we tour around is unparalleled.
And see, that is such a great experience, because you're seeing such a variety of students in different backgrounds and different socioeconomic backgrounds and how they learn and look at all those different things. So you observe them when you go and talk to them. You do all the different things to kind of get your research, and it seems like in every place you visit, right?
You're so right, because if there's one thing we've learned from looking at a college when there aren't students around, the walking backwards tour guide, bless her heart, can point out the $10 million science facility and the $10 million dorm and the $10 million student union. It's another thing altogether to talk to a student on campus and say, tell me, what's the scene? Drugs and alcohol? What about date rape?
Right.
What about class size? Don't tell me what's in the brochures. Tell me what really goes on. And that's the information that's valuable to families, don't you think?
Oh, it's so valuable to families, and families have such different backgrounds. I have 5 kids of my own, David, and what I see is they're so different in so many ways. They're going in different directions. They have some similarities, but when you look at kids, the environment is so key in success in education. If the environment is not the right environment, they can't learn. If they, like you said, when you were working with that student in math and he just didn't get you, and you kept trying and trying, and it was like talking to a wall, you didn't know what was also was going on with him. And then once you said, I got to help the entire student, not just the mind for education, but, you know, did they have the proper breakfast? Did they sleep enough hours? How is home? Is home some place that, you know, it's very dangerous for them to be in? Are they afraid? Very interesting, David. I was evaluating a student who had transferred to another school because of how home life was terrible. And he told me he never studied, never took home a book. And basically, it was never exposed at all to studying, or and basically said, "Well, so what did you do at your old house?" I just hung out on the streets. That's what I did. Never watched TV. So that can really cause a student to not know how to learn, right?
I'm glad that your five kids made the right choice of parents and decided to come and live in your house. Good for them. Your example is perfect. And switching schools, as anyone who's ever been divorced or in an imperfect relationship can tell you, can make the whole difference. And a child for whom home, as you describe, can be imperfect because there's not a quiet place to study, or some of the kids with whom I work, where home is a high pressure, miserable,
Right.
disconnected, unaligned place. Got to get those kids in the situation where they can thrive.
All right. Well, when we get back, David, we're going to really go into your book, Raising Healthy Kids in an Unhealthy Environment. And I love the end of the title because unhealthy environment is so true. What kids have to do with cyberbullying and all the dangers that they deal with every day, and then also dealing with our education system. And it's definitely, they're not focused on educating except test scores. So they're dealing with so many very difficult things to have success, and they're really going through difficulties. Again, you can go to my website, TotalTutor.net, for more information. Twitter, TotalTutor, Neil S. Haley. Facebook. Go ahead and tweet me at TotalTutor with questions for David. And David, I'm definitely have to have him on the show again to be an educational consultant on my radio network for sure. So when we get back, more Author's Corner on the Neil Haley Show. We'll be back in just a moment.
Today we are going to inform you about two types of mental illnesses. First, we are going to tell you about anxiety. Everyone experiences anxiety at one time or another. However, when the anxiety interferes with your life, it's time to consider seeking help. Symptoms of anxiety are uncontrollable and obsessive thoughts, nightmares, shortness of breath, feelings of panic, and fear or uneasiness without reason. Some risk factors for having anxiety are being female, temperament, and stress. One of the most severe forms of anxiety is OCD, or obsessive compulsive disorder. When someone has OCD, they can't tell the difference between a real threat and an irrational fear. Anxiety disorders are some of the most common mental disorders. If anxiety is interfering with your day-to-day life, then speak with your doctor. The other mental illness we are covering today is bipolar disorder. Bipolar disorder causes unusual shifts in mood, energy, and activity levels. There are two sides to bipolar disorder, mania and depression. Symptoms of mania are an overly happy or outgoing mood, extreme irritability, talking very quickly, jumping around, being easily distracted, being overly restless, sleeping little, and engaging in high-risk behaviors. Symptoms of depression are long periods of sadness, loss of interest, feeling tired, having difficulty concentrating and making decisions, being irritable, changing in eating or sleeping habits, and suicidal thoughts. Risk factors of bipolar disorder are genetics and age. Bipolar disorder is sometimes referred to as a manic depressive illness. If you feel that you or a loved one has bipolar disorder, speak with your doctor. For more information on these mental illnesses and more, visit nim.nih.gov.
We're back to the Neil Haley Show, and I'm with author David Altshuler, and I'm having a fascinating conversation with him about first his background and what makes him passionate. And I think, David, you and I have same missions in so many ways, and it's so wild how we were able to connect today on the show.
You beat me 5-4 in the number of children. But otherwise, it sounds like we are having similar experiences, my friend, as we try to keep our children healthy in an unhealthy world. Isn't it something how things have changed and where the dangers are compared to 100 years ago?
Oh, it definitely is. But David, don't you get knocked sometimes when you say that, one generation to the next? Oh, every generation has its problems. Really, do you think that this is a tougher place for kids to grow up? Tell me why that definitely it is.
Your great grandparents lived in a community where the danger was clear. It was outside the home. If the crops failed because of hailstones, then the wheat died, the animals died, and the people died. But inside the house, your great grandfather was the rock, the foundation. There was no disrespect, there was no danger seeping in under the door. In our house today and in yours, process addictions are lurking. Screens with addictive video games, internet pornography, drugs and alcohol at school, the possibility of incipient gambling addictions at every market down the street. It wasn't better to live 100 years ago without antibiotics, where to step on a nail was death, where to drink water, where the chickens had been was death. But it was different, and the danger was more clearly defined. Today, parents, ironically, not only must be hypervigilant about keeping their children safe, but also communicate to their kids that the world can be a safe place as long as they stay away from body image issues, drugs, alcohol, gambling, screen addictions, internet pornography. It's a tricky bit of business.
You're scaring me, David, but that's definitely one thing that I studied. I've done some parenting classes, coaching parenting parents and stuff in parenting groups, and I talk about these dangers, and I talk it to my families, and they don't see it. Leaving a kid at home alone, or not home alone, but in their bedroom with a television and computer, especially let's say an iPhone, and that ability to what they can find out there is so much more dangerous than when I grew up. So, I mean, just imagine what could happen from being abducted to identity theft to exposed to things too early. And how do parents deal with all this for sure?
I could not agree with you more. And the answer, in my judgment, it's not about quality time, it's about quantity time.
Yes.
First, specifically, no screens in private spaces.
Yeah,
If you want to
absolutely.
look at a computer, you sit here at the kitchen table, honey, where mommy and daddy can walk back and forth. If it's a single parent home, if you're being raised by a grandmother, it doesn't make any difference. No screens in private
No.
spaces where you're always three clicks, one lapse in judgment away. Images cannot be taken back. Secondly, listen to that sound. Thwack. As a ball hits a glove, whenever your child says, "I want to go online and play World of Warcraft for 14 consecutive hours because that's what the kid down the street is doing," you communicate silently, "That's not an option. We're going in the backyard. Here's a ball glove. We're not going to talk about homework. We're not going to talk about chores. We're going to toss that ball back and forth. Thwack, thwack. We're not worried about whether you'll be a major league ball player. We're just enjoying being," pun intended in the Buddhist sense, "being together. And if we're going to watch television, you're going to sit right here under my arm, and I'm going to explain anything that makes you feel uncomfortable or that makes me as a parent feel like it's not developmentally appropriate. It's not the right age and stage to look at. We're going to spend time together so that my values, not the values of an advertiser, not the values of a game developer, not the values of a cigarette manufacturer, not the values of the broader culture, are going to be the ones that you, my beloved child, absorb and accept."
No, David, I'm hearing you on this and all these different things, but let's add more to the components to this. Single families, a parent, single parent family, two parents that are working. How do we keep our eye on what's going on when they leave the house? I think we can do it at home very well if we really are diligent. And you said, no, we're not going to have a situation like, have a house, I mean, to make sure that there's screen time where we're not watching them smartphones. Don't give them the exposure to it when they're by themselves at home, especially at night, doing all these different things. But when they leave the house and the friends, different, how do you keep them from being exposed to those things that can lead to those dangers that we've been discussing?
That's why, rather than preparing the path for the child, we prepare the child for the path.
Okay.
And we role play, and we model, and we allow our children to be the one to say, no, thank you. I do not care for an alcoholic beverage.
Okay.
I'm 16. No, thank you. I am not going to choose to smoke marijuana with you because I know that my frontal lobe does not develop completely for another 10 years until I turn 25. We cannot keep our kids wrapped in a bubble, but we certainly can make sure they have the tools, the information, and the ability to say no thank you to the process addictions and other snares of the broader culture.
Do you think Do you think that we make a mistake in thinking that that time at home is a time for parents to relax, especially if there's downtime, and let the kids figure out things for their own? Because this is the most quality time of educating them. So when they do go out to the world, they make the right decisions. And that's what you talked about before, about our great-grandfather and how he was dealing with life and the kids, and they weren't exposed to everything at home, so they were able to teach those values. Now you have to keep those bad values out of the home so that the only time they're exposed to those things are when they leave, and they're kind of been told through educational moments and modeling that this is not the right thing to do, right?
The way to communicate those special moments is to make sure that there are 10 not-so-special moments that precede them. Why would anyone want to listen to someone whom they don't know and don't respect?
Right.
That's why you hang up on telemarketers. That's why over the water cooler you don't engage in political or sports or family discussions with those with whom you have nothing in common. If your children have been brought up by screens in the other room, why would they be interested in listening to the values that you wish to communicate? You've got to set up the home as that foundation,
right?
Safe space.
Exactly.
And then the kids will say, of course I want to grow up to be like my dad.
Yeah, absolutely. You want to, they want to grow up to be like their dad and see these things. And I think that one thing I've always told families out there is the way we react to our kids, the way we show ourselves in the home, the respect that we have towards our wife, the way that we pick up and help around the house and are willing to listen to our children, the more likely they're going to do the same at home and outside the environment. So modeling is so key. What we do as parents is something that will affect our children for a lifetime.
You are so right.
And sometimes our society tells us, let's be hands off, right? And I'm sure you talk to tons of people and are on tons of different radio and television opportunities with all these dangerous things that have happened in our environment, saying, what have we done? You have to be really investigators as parents, especially when they're teenagers, to know what's going on, what their friends are doing. Things that could say, well, mom, dad, why are you doing this? But they're going to know from earlier on that you're setting the stage for this, right? Correct?
You could not be more correct. And the most powerful way to say I love you is to say no. You may not go to a party in that limousine. One of the most powerful ways to say I love you, single family, two working parents, or whatever it is not to be involved in a situation where you say, I don't understand why my child is addicted to OxyContin, why she is hanging out with that low-level drug dealer, why she has two kids out of wedlock. She's not yet 21. Who's going to support my grandchildren if he gets arrested? Again, whenever we smoked marijuana with her when she was in high school, we told her only do it in moderation like we do. That's not going to work.
No, it's
not. Do as we say, not as we do is not going to work. You've got to be with that kid, and you've got to, if you want your kid to be a reader rather than a gamer, then turn off your computer.
Yes.
Stop sending emails.
Yes.
5 o'clock at night, nothing's going to happen until 9 o'clock the next morning. If you're not playing Candy Crush, then you can determine whether or not your child is playing League of Legends.
Yeah, and one thing I try to do is I do a lot of my work at home, but it's not in front of them in a way where they're seeing me with tons of screen time. I put my phone away, start cleaning up the house, start talking to the kids, start doing interacting, putting when I'm home, and I really see specifically I'm not at work. I'm not going to get on a call at this time. I'm not going to do this. And as an entrepreneur, that's really hard, David, but you have to do those things because you're going to completely miss out. Now, with four kids of your own, David, how old are they? Tell us quick stories, and then I want to find out more information on you.
14, 16, 21, and 22. How about you, Neil? You got five.
Oh, wow. Our listeners and viewers know, but I have 9, 5, 4, 2, and 10 months. So
how wonderful, Neil. Good for you.
It's the greatest thing in the world, but yeah, it keeps me young, and that's the important thing, David. So where's the best place where people can find you? And I hope they get to see you at the Miami Book Fair. Our listeners and viewers get to attend Miami. Where can we find info?
www.davidaltshuler.com. That's www.davidaltshuler.com. And Neil, your wonderful listeners are welcome to email me directly. I return every call, every email personally. David@altshulerfamily.com. David@altshulerfamily.com.
We have about 30 seconds. What are you going to be doing? Do you know what you're doing at the Miami Book Fair?
I am going to be reading with my dear friend of many years, Maggie Silverstein, who has published a brilliant, wonderful, magnificent book about photography and children. We're going to chat. Everyone is welcome on Saturday, November 22nd at 3 o'clock in Building 7. I'd be honored to see you there.
All right. Well, David, thanks again for calling and being on the Neil Haley Show and also my radio network. So best of luck. We're going to stay connected, and I'd love to have you back on to talk certain education expertise and stuff. So we'll stay in touch. Okay.
Thank you, Neil.
All right. Take care, Bob. All right. You're watching the Neil Haley Show, and it was a fantastic show today. Really enjoyed the great insight that David was able to bring. Again, my website, totaltutor.net. Have a great week. We'll talk next week.
PPTV. Come volunteer.
If it wasn't fun, I wouldn't be here.
PPTV. Come on in. Make a show. It's still fun after all these years.